over the last little while I've been thinking about some nice new projects to do, keep me going. And one of the things that I've been wanting to do is a nice Viking wood. This is a very ingenious pattern. It's really, really simple to do and only takes a few hours, even if you're hand sewing. Let's take a look. Righto, in this video we're going to make a Skjoldehamn hood, which is based off a find from a place called Skjoldehamn in Norway. I apologize with my pronunciation, I'm probably getting that wrong again. Anyway, alright, let's take a look at that find. So as you can see, it's pretty well preserved, primarily made out of wool, and there's actually a lot we can tell from this particular garment. You can, if you actually look at the original, you can see how the stitching worked, what types of stitches were used, and whether it was stitched. And you can look at the construction of the garment. Alrighty, so let's take a look at the pattern. The pattern for this type of hood, which was common throughout, as we understand it, the whole sort of early medieval period, it's a very simple pattern but very ingenious. It consisted of one large rectangle, and it consisted of two small squares. Now if we look at some... Alrighty, there we go. The only real measurement that you're going to need is the measurement between your two shoulders and the measurement for your face opening. I say that you can see a lot of these within various reenactment groups all around the world, and many of these are done incredibly well. Alrighty, now if we look at the measurements, therefore, now I'm about 6 foot tall, 184 centimeters. And I'm making this for me, so I'm going to go with two squares, which are going to be 32 centimeters each, which means this edge here is going to be 32, and this I'm going to cut at 188 centimeters. All right, now if we talk, those are the finished measurements. So what I mean by that is I need to allow a seam allowance around each piece. I use 2 centimeters, and that means an extra 2 centimeters here and here and here and here. So instead of 32, that number now becomes 36 and 36, which is actually what I'm going to cut. Okay, now let's talk materials. Primarily we're looking at wool. Alright, so in the early medieval period, we could be looking at wool from a goat or a sheep. Alright, now I am going to line my hood with linen, which will just be a very basic commercially available linen. In Australia, linen is available fairly easily through most haberdashery stores, and the two big chains we have are Lincraft and Spotlight. Alrighty, now let's talk colours. Contrary to a lot of popular belief, the early medieval period, in fact the whole medieval period, was very much a vividly alive with colour. However, colours would have differed slightly to do with the social class and status. So if we think about the low classes, then they would probably be wearing a range of beige through brown through to some of the basic sort of yellows. So browns could be made using walnut, yellows from marigold. If we look at the middle classes, lower and sort of upper middle classes, I guess, then you're looking at sort of more yellows to greens, maybe incorporating some blues as we get more wealthy. Greens from a plant called madder, blues from a plant called woad. However, that would probably need to be commercially grown or propagated and that kind of thing, because woad is a plant that strips the soil of a great deal of nutrient. What does that mean? Well, it means that you really have to look after the plant in order to get the best sort of value out of it. It does require a lot of water and it does require a great deal of nutrition. For the very sort of high echelons of society, we're talking here royalty, upper clergy, the earldoms and jarldoms and those kind of people. We may also incorporate red and purple. Purple can actually be achieved through types of shellfish that would have been available to the Europeans at the time. And some of these people may have incorporated trims of perhaps silk or those kind of fabrics which could have come across from the Byzantine sort of empire. Alrighty, so that's all of our research done. Now let's get cutting. I realized I messed up with my mass, fortunately, before I started cutting. But here we go, here's the pieces that we have to work with. Two small squares, each 32 by 32 centimeters finished. One long rectangle, that's 32 centimeters by 128. And that's of wool, and then the same with the coarse linen. Alrighty, let's get some sewing done. Rightio, some of you guys are probably wondering, how does this all come together? It's actually super simple, but it's such an ingenious pattern. If we fold the hood in like the long rectangle in half, and then we have the two small squares in half, essentially what we're going to do . If this is where the face hole is, so to speak, then we're going to sew up and down this seam here, up and down this seam here, and up and down the back. Now I've chosen to line mine with coarse linen. Not everybody did, not everyone does, and that's okay. It's entirely up to you. I find the linen helps to reduce the wind chill. So if we start sewing one of those edges, now I'm simply repurposing a blanket that I purchased from a charity shop. Herringbone wool is probably the most historically accurate. In terms of stitch types, I would strongly suggest using something like a running back stitch or similar. It needs to be strong enough to last. Something like this should last you forever, like really years and years and years. It really shouldn't need to have a failure to it, but it's probably going to come down a little bit to how you look after it. I keep my gear for each person in my family, so my kids each have their own and I have my own Osborg style chests, so one for my armor and one for my so-called soft kit or my
kind of costume, I suppose. And there we go. It keeps my gear out of the way. It keeps it tidy when I'm not using it. I use it a lot. I do train a lot with it, and I find, you know, that gives a lot of purpose to my life. There we go. Alrighty. So, something like this is not going to take you long to make. Even by hand stitching, you should only take really a few hours to sew from scratch. You can machine sew these, that's fine. So a lot of people do. I'm hand stitching this one because I like to have that bit of extra sort of, I guess, pride in my work, and I've got a little bit of extra time on my hands at the moment, like most people. But there we go. Alrighty, let's see how we go. Your stitch length for a running back stitch is historically around about 6 millimeters. That's 1/4 of an inch, sometimes a bit smaller. As long as it's consistent, I think that's the main thing you're looking for. But these are hidden seams anyway, so I don't really think it matters that much. What matters really is the top seams, but we'll talk about those a little bit later. Alrighty, so let's try it on, see how we go. Pretty much exactly what I was looking for. It is nice and close. It does give you lots of room. It does really kind of protect your shoulders and your upper chest and that kind of thing. And this is a really nice size for me. So let's do the lining. So now what we're doing is we're going to start sewing the three pieces of linen together. I don't really think it makes any difference, like whether you have coloured or not. Linen was a lining fabric. In fact, that's even where the word linen comes from. And it was used to line literally just about everything. Same as before, I'm just doing a running back stitch. Oops, getting a bit tangled up here. There we go. So what projects are you doing during the lockdown? I'm very interested to know. Are you redoing your costuming? Are you making new garments? Have your kids grown? Do they need new garments? I'm basically using my time to make everybody a new set. Even though we're coming towards the end of the reenactment period for this year in Australia, and essentially, as far as I know, all of the events are essentially cancelled, which is a real shame. Hopefully they'll be back up and running next year. That would be really interesting to see. But I'm using my time to make everyone really from scratch a new costume, a new Osborg chest, and some new items. So lots and lots and lots of videos still coming out. Lots of really interesting content. I think it's going to be really quite interesting to see how people react to some of these videos. Not just are we're doing some of the historical stuff where we analyse what's going on with the different cultures, but we're also doing a lot of videos around some new things, like some historical quivers. We'll be doing a whole new series on longbow archery, and we'll sort of see how that progresses. I'm really looking forward to a time, maybe next year, when I can do some crossbow archery. That would be quite interesting. Crossbows actually date a lot further back than a lot of people realize, but we'll be doing that hopefully for 2021, maybe 2022. We'll just have to see how that plays through. But I'll be making each of my daughters a new costume, and a new costume for my son. So we'll see how that all develops. Alrighty, now in a few minutes we'll have all of this stitching done. It's very simple. There's really not much to do. This is such an amazingly simple but yet a very effective pattern. I really like this, and I wear these a lot during the colder months. It doesn't get that cold here in Brisbane, But what I do find is a cloak and that kind of stuff is really too much. And unless you're camping and you're in an environment where it is colder and you can wear it a bit during the morning and a bit in the evening. But for most of the time, I really find just a hood like this is more than enough. And I also find that it works for me because it's just such a... keeps my chest and my back warm and my neck and my head without sort of making me too hot. Because even in the winter, it does heat up a lot during the day. Alrighty, so trying on the lining, and you can see this has come out really, really, really well as well. This is such an ingenious pattern. It just works so well, and it's so easy to make. A couple of hours of time, a blanket from an op shop or a charity shop, that kind of thing, a little bit of linen. It costs you, what, maybe $10 at most. And for the blanket, you might pay sort of $15 or $20 max. There's a lot going around, coming up towards the end of winter, so there's a lot being sold. Really fantastic. Okay, now we're going to put the two pieces together. Rightio, it's really simple. Before you make a start, just make sure that all of your seams are consistently on one side. Rightio, now my linen goes inside with the seams pointing outwards, whilst, and just quickly check my seams, fantastic, all right. So the wool, the seams face inwards. That way I'm not going to see any seams at all. Just line everything up. And then all we're doing is we're going to turn the linen in about a centimeter. That's roughly speaking just under half an inch. And do the same with the wool. So you've got everything facing itself, and then we just stitch that down, and then everything is finished. And you do that for all of your seams. So all you're doing really is going to sew right around the bottom and then just on the face opening. This has come out so well and I'm so happy with it. It's a really nice contrast to the yellow tunic, yet still a nice and plausible dye. Even though this is the commercial sort of wool, it's still plausible for a plant-based dye. Fantastic, it's nice and very simple, very easy to make, and it's nice and warm and it keeps me out of the cold on a blustery day like today. Really happy with this. I really hope you enjoyed today's video. Please like, subscribe and share. I'll catch you in my next video.